Hello learners, today I am going to present the types of poetry part 3. We have seen till now what is an ode and what is the lyric. Today a very famous form of the poetry is there for our discussion, that is the sonnet. So let's start with the sonnet. The question may arise in our mind at first that what is a sonnet? Sonnet is quite a common form again. Many poets since beginning till now are writing and practicing various kind of sonnet. So sonnet is a lyric poem. Again, parent form is lyric form. You have to just consider in your mind. It comprises 14 rhyming lines of equal length, written in iambic pentameter in England and other meters in France and Italy. So here we must know that it is iambic pentameter, and this is a meter, you know that, where 5 unstressed and stressed syllables come one after other. So iambic pentameter is very important point here. So where was it originated? Well, it's suppose that sonnet was originated in Italy, and particularly two towns were there. One is Sicily and second was Provence. The word sonnet was derived from Italian sonetto, which means a little sound or strain. And when sonnet came actually in England, you know, two persons were responsible at that time who were actually some sort of politician or involved in political scenario. They were the Henry Howard, Earl of Surrey, and other was his friend. So both were responsible and they just brought it here in England. So Surrey actually used sonnet, and he took his freedom to invent and to experiment with the form. Then Shakespeare used it so much, he liked this form so much that people started calling his Shakespearean sonnet in England. So this was connected with the sonnet. So let us come to types of sonnet. Sonnets are of two types. One is called the Italian or Petrarchan sonnet, and second is the English sonnet, which I was talking about, Shakespearean sonnet. So we will discuss and we will also analyze that what are the forms, various forms of sonnet, and what are the differences between these two. So let's start with the first type of the sonnet. One is called the Petrarchan sonnet. You know that Italian sonneteer Petrarch actually experimented with the form, and that's why it is known as Petrarchan sonnet, and it is sometimes also called as classical sonnet because it was modeled modeled by everyone after Petrarch. So it worked as a norms of sonnet. You know what is classical? Classical is always bound by some norms and rules and regulations. So that's why people started taking Petrarchan sonnet as a classical model. So let us talk about that two types of sonnets, two parts of sonnets are there. In Petrarchan sonnet, there are actually, if we talk about the form and the structure about the sonnet, so we come to know that there are two forms in the Petrarchan sonnet. There are two main sections of the sonnet. The first section is called the octave, and that comprises the 8 lines, and then comes the sestet, and that comprises 6 lines. In total, then it becomes 14 lines, which is the criteria for the sonnet to become a sonnet. So let's analyze much more seriously here, and I have just drawn a figure meticulously so that nothing remains unexplained, or nobody can be confused in that kind of structure or form. This is a very meticulous figure. Let's analyze this figure here. With dotted lines from 1 to 14, I have shown symbolically 14 lines of a sonnet. And then if we see that the structure of Petrarchan sonnet, the rhyme scheme of the Petrarchan sonnet says that A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A, C, D, E, C, D, E. So 8 lines octave is composed of 2 quatrain, and quatrain is composed of 4 lines. So in 8 lines, 2 segment of 4 lines come, therefore 2 quatrains are there. And both quatrains are A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A. And you know that octave is fixed in rhyme scheme, but in Petrarchan sonnet there might be 3 variations in sestet. One is CD, CD, सेकेंड वेरिएशन इज शोन विद द और सी डी सी डी सी डी एंड थर्ड वेरिएशन इज शोन सी डी ई डी सी ई. सो दीज थ्री लाइन्स ऑफ सेस्टेट, फर्स्ट थ्री लाइन्स टर्सेट देन अगेन टर्सेट, सो थ्री लाइन्स कंपोज ऑफ टर्सेट मेक्स ए टर्सेट, अगेन द अदर थ्री लाइन्स मेक्स ए टर्सेट, सो बोथ टर्सेट्स कंबाइंडली मेक्स सेस्टेट. सो दीज आर अबाउट द स्ट्रक्चर एंड टू एरो द रेड एरो मार्क टू इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स. एक्चुअली व्हेन ए सोनेट इज रिटन इन एट्थ लाइन देयर इज ए मार्क पंक्चुएशन और मार्क फुल स्टॉप और समथिंग विच एक्चुअली क्रिएट ए पॉज देयर आफ्टर एट्थ लाइन. सो दिस पॉज इज कॉल्ड सेजुरा एंड इट इज सपोज दैट वट एवर थॉट प्रोसेस और वट एवर थॉट लाइनिंग वॉज गोइंग ऑन इन द माइंड ऑफ द पोएट इट बिकम्स टू ए स्टॉप इन दिस पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट. And when we start with the ninth line, so a new thought process come on, new idea takes place or the poem turn towards a new thought or new idea. And that's why it is called Volta. So Volta represents a introduction of new thought, initiation of new thought. While that pause at the eighth, end of the eighth line is represents the pause or the stopping of the first idea which was being discussed. So this is called caesura. So I hope that this structure is clear now. So let's move to the next slide. I have shown one example of Petrarchan sonnet which was written by Milton, and when the assault was intended to the city it is a sonnet, and this is 14 lines of the poem is shown here. So I am taking this as an example and now analyzing this in respect to the structure which we have just discussed just now. So let us analyze this according to the structure we have already discussed here. So let's see that the first four lines means quatrain ABBA. I have just distributed the first four lines in that captain or colonel or knight in arms who chance on these defenseless door may seize. If deed of honor did thee ever please, guard them and him within protect from harms. So if you see that arms and harms, AA and then B rhyme is seize and please. So again these four lines makes a quatrain and this is one part of the octave. Then second four lines, other part of the octave. And at the last eighth line there is a caesura I have shown with a circle which was or which is a red circle with a black arrow there. Here comes the stop to the first thought. Then again next sixth line, first part, the terset, CDC, and Volta starts here, means new thoughts. Lift not thy spear against the muse's power. The great Emathian conqueror bid spare the house of Pindarus when temple and tower. So CDC, and again DCD. DCD, see the air, bear are rhyming, and par is a different rhyme. So DCD. So these are this is a poem which is analyzed according to the Petrarchan structure. Now this was the first form which was supposed as classical form also. Now when this sonnet was taken by other writers to the England, what happened with the sonnet, let's see in the next part of the sonnet. Second type is the English sonnet and it is also called Shakespearean sonnet. So let us go through some facts about this sonnet. It was introduced into England in the first half of the 16th century. And I told you that by Sir Thomas Wyatt and Henry Howard, Earl of Surrey. They were actually English politicians who returned from a diplomatic mission in Italy and wrote verses in this form for pleasure. So they used to write for their pleasure. They had no intention that they wanted to become a great writer of the son or a sonneteer, but they used to write it. So Surrey particularly worked upon this and introduced a change form of Italian model. Somehow he introduced somewhere some changes, whatever Italian model he was imitating actually, and which he took from the Petrarchan form. And then after he had written some of the this new form of the sonnets, so Shakespeare went through these forms and he liked this and the rhyme scheme, the music involved in the sonnet. So Shakespeare was quite impressed by, and then he used it so widely that people started naming it as Shakespearean sonnet. Though the originator was not the Shakespeare, it is a very important point. that Surrey actually introduced this sonnet here, the English sonnet, which is named, which where that Shakespeare is given that it is titled by the name of Shakespearean sonnet, but Shakespeare is not the person who actually originated this form. Now I am going to just show its structure with an example. Again, the example is the again a sonnet by William Shakespeare, sonnet number 30, Remembrance. So let's see about the structure of this sonnet. So here, something different from the Petrarchan sonnet. In Petrarchan sonnet, there were octave and sestet, but in Shakespearean sonnet, there are three quatrain. So three quatrains mean four lines in each quatrain, and the rhyme scheme is quite different. Rhyme scheme is AB, AB, CD, CD, and then EF, EF, and last couplet GG. So the division of the 14 lines goes like this, that three quatrain, which comprises of 12 lines, and last remaining two lines makes a couplet which conclude the sonnet. So ABAB, again I have shown in the structure, and then second quatrain CDCD, and third quatrain EFEF, and fourth is GG. So now a question in your mind may arise, that is there any caesura after eighth line? No, there is no caesura after eighth line. Rather, the caesura comes up the stop comes after the 12th line. So caesura is in the 12th line, and the volta, which is turn in thought, comes in the last couplets in two line. So in a way, these two line actually work as a conclusion, and it just conclude the entire poem in a different way. So caesura and volta takes a different turn in comparison to Petrarchan sonnet. So here again in rhyme you can see the difference, that in Petrarchan sonnet the sestet used to vary into three rhymes, but here the second part GG remains the same. Now people may ask, that is there any other variety of sonnet also? Yes, sometimes a third type of sonnet is also being discussed, though it is not widely used as we have used the English sonnet or Petrarchan sonnet, but still we must discuss it because we must go through the topic thoroughly. So the last one is the Spenserian variety. Spenser also tried to just give a variation to this sonnet form. So let us try to understand its point. It is worth noticing that Shakespearean sonnet are all unconnected with one another. This is very important point, that Shakespearean sonnets are all unconnected with one another. They have each their own rhymes and cannot therefore be said to be related structurally, though they are united by the subject matter. Subject matter is the same, but structurally they differ. But Spenser had evolved a new variety in which each of the quatrain was linked to the other by an intermixture of the rhymes in the following manner. So here Spenser makes an experiment. Suppose he has taken quatrain of ABAB, so the fifth line will start from the last rhyme scheme of the fourth line. Means if ABAB is coming, so fifth line will start from B, so it will the next quatrain be BCBC, and the next quatrain will start from C, CDCD, and again the couplet is same as it was in Shakespearean form EE. So it becomes like this. If we go through the example, it is one sonnet again, Spenserian sonnet. So we see that in eight line, ye dreadful merchants that with weary toil. So here from AB, AB, then it is start with the same B, BC, BC, and it is start with the same C at the end, CD, CD, and the last couplets remain different. So again here 14 lines, but in a way, connected intermix connection of the rhyme scheme is there, and the last rhyme takes the next line. So these are the Spenserian sonnet. And now come to the last slide, that is what kind of subjects we discuss in sonnets. So actually students, we cannot this sonnet subject in one or two subjects. No set of range of subject for the sonnet. Shakespeare and Elizabethan, they limited sonnets to a theme of love and related with love affairs and this all. But in Milton's hand, the scope of the sonnet was greatly widened, and in time, when that further time, in further time, sonnet actually developed in different into different kind of subjects, it came to conclude almost everything within the range of human feelings and experience. So now you cannot just claim that sonnet is used only for love or love affection or such kind of feeling. Rather, nowadays sonnet can be used in any form, or sorry, in any kind of topics to describe any kind of human feelings, and it is a musical poem, and this parent form is lyric. So I hope that with this third part of the poetry, I could justify with the new topic, the sonnet. And if you go through the slides, you can come to know, you can come to understand the differences between all kind of sonnets. And students, it is these this content is well researched out content, and you can just go through my references, and you can go through the book if you want to just get the deep knowledge. Thank you. I hope that you are enjoying this session, and thank you. See you with the new topic in the next lecture. Thanks a lot.